Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Depression, What Everyone Needs to Know, by Jonathan Rottenberg, narrated by Kevin Rineer. Part 1. Definitions of Depression. 1. The Challenge of Defining Depression. What is depression? A surprisingly difficult question. Depression has spawned thousands of books, yet one enduring view is that depression is somehow beyond words, at least when we try to describe the experience. I believe that launching more words and even another book about depression is not a futile or vain effort, but let's grant, the subject is full of paradoxes. Depression is at once intensely private and the most public of problems. People who go through depression are cut off from others, even as they experience symptoms that are shared by millions. Clinical depression is at once a pressing crisis. The World Health Organization deems it the most burdensome global health problem and a condition met with shrugs. Despite the severity of the problem and the vast number of people affected, depression garners surprisingly little public mobilization. People don't march against depression, or hold golf tournaments, or dance marathons to benefit those who suffer. Another puzzle is that depression exerts the most visible of effects. The many calculable losses tallied by epidemiologists and economists, be it loss of work productivity and income, broken marriages, or even deaths by suicide. And yet, at the same time, depression is also invisible and incalculable. There is no test of blood, urine, or genes for depression. Those affected have no obvious stigmata. There is no single telltale sign of the condition. Then, there is the great imprecision in how people throw around the term depression. Colloquially, the phrase, "I'm so depressed," is said as a response to a multitude of everyday disappointments. When rain spoils your picnic, when new couch gets coffee stained, when concert tickets for your favorite band sell out. Such trivial uses of the term depression suggest that depressed people must be whiners and complainers who exaggerate the severity of their problem. Making matters worse, the same term depression is also used by clinicians, scientists, and everyday people to mark the most catastrophic of states. When a person is unable to get out of bed, unable to work, unable to self-care, and even consumed by thoughts of suicide. When a single term is used to cover so much territory, widespread confusion about what exactly depression is seems almost inevitable. So if we are to cut through the many misunderstandings that surround depression, we need to simplify. Let's begin with its incontrovertible essence. Depression is a kind of mood. Within us all, we are endowed by evolution with a mood system. This system responds to threats and opportunities in somewhat predictable ways. When we make quick progress towards important life goals, our mood is usually good. When we are blocked in our progress or move away from important life goals, our mood is low. Mood reflects the availability of key resources in the environment, both external, e.g. food, allies, and potential mates, and internal, e.g. fatigue, hormone levels, and adequacy of hydration, and ensures that any animal does not waste precious time and energy on fruitless or even dangerous efforts, such as doing a mating dance when predators are lurking. Given that resources of every sort, be they time, energy, or money, are finite, expending resources on unreachable goals can be ruinous. The mood system is capable of great variety, from energized highs to everyday blahs to the more severe moods, which we call clinical depression. The mood system has power over our minds and bodies. Depression is the textbook demonstration of this power. Mood colors our thinking. When we are depressed, thoughts turn to loss, failure, or incapacity. Mood biases our actions. When depressed, we may withdraw, cancel plans, or give up entirely. Mood states even influence our physiology. During depression, the body is aroused, locked in a state of dread, night after night. Sleep will be elusive. The endowment of a capacity for mood inevitably brings with it the potential for both good moods and bad moods, including the unpleasant mood states we call clinical depression. It is likely that virtually everyone has at least some capacity for depression. However, this does not mean that depression is the same for everyone. On the contrary, depression affects different people in different ways. It has many different faces. For some, depression may come out more as a disturbance in thinking. For others, bodily symptoms and motivational changes might be the most prominent. For others still, painful emotions are the focal point. Depression may feel wrong or uncomfortable, but there's not a right or wrong way to be depressed. Depression will likely mean different things to the tycoon on his yacht, the homeless woman living under the bridge, the insurance salesman, or the fashion model, with each appreciating their moods through the prism of their own life history and self-understanding. Saying depression is a mood and part of a larger mood system orients us. Being oriented is the first step to helping us think more deeply about what depression is and where it comes from. Much complexity remains. As we will hear in the coming book, many different forces act upon the mood system. These include forces we are aware of, such as environmental effects, the health of our relationships, our diet, sleep habits, physical activity, light exposure, as well as our own thoughts. But the mood system is also acted upon by unseen forces, forces of which we are not aware, such as the operations of our immune system or stress hormones. Both seen and unseen forces act on the mood system simultaneously. This fact almost guarantees that humans will face a degree of uncertainty about why they are depressed. This book takes our uncertain posture towards moods as both an assumption and a point of departure for gaining a better understanding of depression. It is natural that the depressed person wonders, "Why me?" or "Why now?" And it can be frustrating to individuals or their loved ones when there are no obvious answers to these questions. Nevertheless, it is possible to become a more educated consumer of one's own mood, and this book is intended to provide help toward that end. This education includes how to know the differences between depression and normal mood variation, how to better understand the forces that act on mood, and how to better control those forces, including what individuals can do for themselves and how to access additional help from professionals. How has depression been defined throughout history? Depression appears as one of the great perils of our times. We read stories about rising rates of depression and commentary that connects it to contemporary trends, such as increased use of social media or the ways a gig economy negatively affects workers. The psychological challenges of living amid the COVID-19 pandemic have also fed perceptions that depression is arising in many countries, perhaps to unprecedented levels. Is depression a modern condition? A glance at history challenges the idea that depression is a malady of the moment. Throughout the centuries, people may have varied in their beliefs about the causes of depression or what should be done about it. Yet, the actual descriptions of depression, its key features, and how it alters a person's thoughts and behaviors show remarkable constancy. Something akin to our modern depression has existed throughout much of recorded history. Written accounts of a condition similar to what we now know as depression appeared in the 2nd millennium BC in Mesopotamia. One text describes when a man had suffered a long spell of misfortune. "He shakes with fear in his bedroom, and his limbs have become weak to an extreme degree. If he is filled with anger against God and king, and if he is sometimes so frightened that he cannot sleep by day or night, and constantly sees disturbing dreams, if he is weak from not having enough food and drink, and if in speech he forgets the word which he is trying to say, then the anger of his god and goddess is upon him." In these writings, depression was discussed as a spiritual rather than a physical problem, one that might be caused by demonic possession. One did not call a doctor, rather, one needed to hail a priest. The ancient Greeks and Romans recognized melancholia, a condition that again appears akin to our modern depression. For example, in Orestes, Euripides depicts the tragedy's protagonist hounded by the Furies after killing his mother. Orestes' symptoms of depression resemble those of any modern suburbanite: loss of appetite, excess sleeping, lack of motivation to even bathe, constant weeping, chronic exhaustion, and a sense of helplessness. Greek and Roman authorities on melancholia were split into different camps about its causes. Hippocrates' take on melancholia, or a condition of the fears and despondencies if they last a long time, was that it was a biological illness caused by an imbalance in four body liquids called humors: yellow bile, black bile, phlegm, and blood. Specifically, melancholia was attributed to an excess of black bile in the spleen. Hippocrates' treatments of choice to readjust the humors via bloodletting, baths, exercise, and diet. By contrast, Roman philosopher and statesman Cicero took another view of melancholia, seeing its roots in psychological events such as rage, fear, and grief. All the while, another great swath of opinion continued to believe that melancholy and other mental disturbances were caused by demons and by the anger of the gods. In the Middle Ages, Christian religious views dominated European thinking on mental illness. Mental health problems, such as depression, were largely a sign of God's disfavor, indicating a sinful life and/or a need for repentance. A sea change in thinking came with Robert Burton's 17th century Anatomy of Melancholy. This widely read book offered a variety of explanations of melancholy, including more secular, social, and psychological reasons, such as poverty, fear, and loneliness. Burton also included a number of non-religious recommendations for treating it, such as diet, exercise, travel, purgatives to clear toxins from the body, bloodletting, herbs, and music therapy. Even if depression cures, such as purging or leeches, now seem foreign, anatomy's descriptions of melancholy accord with contemporary psychiatry textbook descriptions of the psychology of the depressed person. Burton lays out an episodic melancholy, which goes and comes upon every small occasion of sorrow, need, sickness, trouble, fear, grief, passion, or perturbation of the mind, any manner of care, discontent, or thought which causes anguish, dullness, heaviness, and vexation of spirit, anyways opposite to pleasure, mirth, joy, delight, causing forwardness in us, or a dislike. In the 20th century, the contemporary term depression gradually came into wider use. Many credit the pioneering 19th century psychiatrist Emile Kraepelin for increasing the popularity of the word, as well as for the view that depression was due to brain pathology, which remains an important strand in mental health thinking to this day. At the same time, new ideas from Freud and his acolytes viewed depression as resulting from intrapsychic conflict, anger turned inward, a conflict that could be best addressed by talk therapy. To this day, biological perspectives on depression continue to coexist with a variety of psychological and psychosocial perspectives. The 20th century also ushered in the more standardized diagnosis of depression that currently prevails. As part of a larger effort to handle mental illness similarly to biological diseases, psychologists and psychiatrists put together the first American Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, DSM, in 1952. In this first manual, which has since gone through several iterations, the term depressive reaction was used to describe a condition of severe low mood resulting from an internal conflict or an identifiable event, such as job loss or divorce. In the DSM's current incarnation, the principal place where depression is discussed is the syndrome major depressive disorder, which will become familiar later in this book. Obviously, a Roman soldier, a Greek philosopher, a French peasant, and a New York City cabbie might have very different reasons for becoming depressed. And the authorities of the day would likely offer very different ideas about what each of these persons should do about it, from baths to bloodletting, exorcism, and Prozac. But in another sense, no matter where we turn in history, depression is depression. Each historical personage would likely experience similar symptoms and behave in similar ways, despite the wide gulfs of culture and language between them. It is important to bear in mind that the evolutionary forces that sculpted our mood system move at a glacial geologic pace. Evolutionary change is much slower than the pace of human events. Our world of airplanes, computers, and electricity presents us with an unimaginably different physical and psychological environment from what the first Homo sapiens faced 300,000 years ago. Yet, the nervous system that generates mood is basically the same as that of early Homo sapiens. Because the architecture of our mood system cannot keep up with the furious pace of human events, different historical periods will trigger different amounts of depression in the population. E.g., there is likely more depression in the United States now than in 1950, even as the essential form that depression takes remains the same. 2. The syndrome of clinical depression. What are the symptoms of depression? Depression is a syndrome. A syndrome is a package of symptoms that group together in a non-random way. An example of a syndrome is a strep throat, where the package of symptoms might include a fever, bumps on the tonsils, pain in swallowing, and swollen lymph nodes. In this case, these symptoms package together because streptococcal bacteria have infected the body, prompting a cascade of responses. Confidence that these symptoms signal a genuine syndrome is high. Biological testing can verify the presence of infectious bacterium as a causative agent. By contrast, the syndrome of depression is not based on objective tests. Instead, it rests largely on observation of symptoms and on accumulated clinical wisdom. A variety of clinicians and researchers have noticed over time that certain psychological complaints are packaged together. Patients who complain of a low mood, for example, also tend to complain of fatigue and sleep difficulty. When enough of these symptoms co-occur, they can be diagnosed as the full depression syndrome, which is also called a major depressive episode. Ultimately, a depression diagnosis is founded on a careful assessment of a patient's symptoms, piecing together what the patient says, as well as how the patient is behaving. Although a clinician can filter or interpret the information provided by the patient, it is ultimately the patient's report of symptoms that grounds a diagnosis rather than the state of their blood or brain. So, what are the symptoms of depression? I illustrate the 9 symptoms of depression with the case of Lonnie, a 24-year-old freelance writer who has become depressed after the breakup of a long-distance relationship. Full disclosure, Lonnie is not a single identifiable depressed person. Like other cases presented in this book, she is a composite, sketched from the many interviews with depressed people I have conducted over the course of my research studies. Cardinal symptoms. 2 symptoms are considered so characteristic of depression that one or both are required for diagnosis. A sad, low mood that the person can't shake. Lonnie describes her mood as hollow. Most days during the past 3 months, she has felt empty or gloomy most of the time. Occasionally, her mood brightens for an hour or two, sometimes for no obvious reason. Unfortunately, these lighter periods don't last. A loss of interest or pleasure in things the person usually enjoys, which goes by the technical term anhedonia, which can apply to hobbies, friends, or sexual relations. Lonnie loves fashion, and her professional writing covers the fashion industry. But since she has become depressed, she doesn't open any of the glossy magazines or mail-order catalogs that she receives. These pile up unread on her coffee table. Her best girlfriends call her to make a date, hoping to cheer her up. She declines. Normally extroverted, Lonnie prefers now to keep to herself. associated symptoms. In addition to the cardinal symptoms, there are 7 other associated symptoms of depression. A person must have at least 5 of the 9 symptoms in total to be diagnosed. Sleep problems. Sleep problems can manifest as an inability to fall asleep or to stay asleep. The opposite pattern, sleeping much more than usual, is another possibility, but it is not as common. Lonnie's case evidences classic insomnia. Every night she falls asleep like a ton of bricks, only to wake up around 3 a.m. 4 hours before her alarm. Instead of falling back to sleep, she lies in bed ruminating on her failures, on what went wrong in her relationship, dreading the coming of the next day. Problems with mental focus. This can appear as concentration problems or as an inability to make decisions. Lonnie struggles with her writing. She also detects that her mind is not working right when she finds herself in the grocery aisle, paralyzed in front of a display, unable to choose which kind of sandwich bag to buy. Changes in weight or appetite. The depressed person most typically will lose weight and eat less due to depression, not an intentionally planned diet. Sometimes depression can bring about the reverse pattern of increased weight or appetite. Lonnie had this symptom in a dramatic fashion. Previously a gourmet cook who loved food, she has dropped 2 sizes during the past 3 months and has to force herself to eat, often skipping meals. When asked about her appetite, she says, "These days, I want to eat about as much as I want to clean the toilets." Fatigue or loss of energy. Depressed people typically state that they feel tired most or all of the time. Lonnie continually feels run down. She has to rally herself to perform the most routine of tasks, such as taking her poodle for a walk around the neighborhood. She describes this tired feeling as like the worst ever hangover, without the fun of a party the night before. Pathological guilt. The depressed person is often racked by pervasive guilt about things that they have done or not done. Depressed people often come to doubt their fundamental worth as a person. Lonnie feels guilty for being born. In her mind, she continually goes over the ways she has been a terrible friend and a lousy daughter. She is haunted by the thought, "I am a waste of space." Psychomotor changes. Most typically, the depressed person talks or moves more slowly than normal. Some depressed people show the reverse pattern of agitation and restlessness. With Lonnie, her family and her therapist both notice that her speech is slowed. When she talks on the phone, her voice is a monotone. When asked a question, there are inexplicably long pauses before she responds. Suicidality. Suicidality is the most frightening of depression's symptoms. The depressed person may have general thoughts about the topic of death, or specific thoughts of hurting themselves, which can lead to planning or attempting suicide. Lonnie's case, this manifests as a passive death wish. As she drives on a 2-lane highway, she wonders if it might be better if the oncoming car swerved in front of her. Other common features. In addition to the previously discussed 9 official symptoms, there are other behaviors that are also highly characteristic of depressed persons. Although they do not make the diagnostic manual as part of the recognized syndrome, they are very much worth noting. Anxiety. Anxiety is like depression's shadow. Most depressed people report elevated levels of anxiety. Lonnie is constantly on edge. Her muscles feel tense. She worries constantly that she won't get better and that she will lose her job and all of her savings. Self-focused thinking. One of the most characteristic things depressed people do is focus on themselves. Lonnie spends extended periods each day in solitary thought, trying to understand why she is depressed. She keeps a journal in which she tracks her mood hour by hour and tries to connect any mood change to her activities and sleep. She dwells on her failings, she returns again and again to the idea that God or some unseen power might be punishing her by keeping her depressed. Pessimism. Depressed people believe that the future will be worse than the present. It is a great struggle for them to maintain any degree of hope. Lonnie doubts that her antidepressant medications will be able to make her better. She doubts that she will be strong enough to survive her depression if it continues another 6 months. She's essentially one giant doubt. In her worst moments, she thinks to herself, "My life is over." Unexplained aches and pains. Depressed people commonly report physical complaints such as headaches, back pain, aching muscles, and stomach pain. One odd thing Lonnie noticed before she was diagnosed with depression was a pain on the left side of her chest. She worried something might be wrong with her heart, even though she was an athletic person in her 20s. After a medical workup, her family doctor could find no explanation for her chest pain complaint. Ultimately, this pain complaint would just be attributed to the depression as yet another mysterious element of the condition. Irritability. Depressed people often feel agitated, restless, and short-tempered. Lonnie has days where everything and everyone gets on her nerves. Sometimes she gets so charged up that she struggles to find a safe outlet for her furious rage. She's angry with her family, angry with her ex-boyfriend, angry with her dog, angry with the entire situation. She doesn't scream and yell at those who have wronged her. She mostly holds it in, her main release going to her bedroom and punching into her pillows. Self-medicating. Depressed people often struggle so much with their moods that they are understandably tempted to abuse substances to control them. Self-medication goes far beyond how patients might take liberties with their antidepressant drug prescriptions. It includes a variety of other substances, chemicals that might be used to drown out pain or take the edge off anxiety. This includes drinking alcohol excessively, abusing opiates or sleep medications, or becoming addicted to anti-anxiety drugs such as Valium. For her part, Lonnie has become dependent on her sleep medications. Her pill stash is her dirty little secret. She is always experimenting with it. She hopes that if she takes the right amount of the drug at the right time, she will be able to sleep through the night. But this seldom happens. She instead ends up with the worst case: poor quality sleep and feeling woozy the next day, slowed down by the after effects of the sleep medicine. How is clinical depression different from a sad mood? Clinical depression is diagnosed when patients report at least 5 of 9 of the official symptoms of a major depressive episode, and when these symptoms are experienced for at least 2 consecutive weeks. Unfortunately, Lonnie is well in excess of these thresholds. However, we should recognize that the 5 of 9 symptoms threshold for clinical depression is somewhat arbitrary. Arbitrary boundaries are common in many diagnostic thresholds. For example, the exact number at which high blood pressure begins is more a convention than demarking a specific boundary of a disease. The boundary for defining clinical depression, although important for guiding decisions, should not be considered completely absolute. Many people have troubling depression symptoms that fall short of the threshold for diagnosis. Imagine Chuck, who recently reports 3 depression symptoms. He has lost interest in activities, can't sleep, and is experiencing constant fatigue. These symptoms cause him distress and hinder his work as a school principal. In clinical practice, people such as Chuck, who have sub-threshold symptoms of depression, might be monitored for any worsening of their condition, or they might be treated immediately, depending on the clinical judgment of the practitioner. Milder forms of depression are common, simply because all forms of depression are very common. The existence of these milder forms of depression raises a larger question. How exactly is clinical depression different from ordinary misery or even a garden variety sad mood? In a key way, clinical depression is not different in kind from an ordinary sad mood. clinical depression and ordinary sad moods are both products of the same mood system. Factors such as environmental stress or not getting enough sleep that render a person more vulnerable to clinical depression are the very same factors that render a person vulnerable to a garden variety sad mood. From this perspective, the difference between clinical depression and an ordinary sad mood is just a matter of degree. Even if it is made from the same building blocks as a sad mood, clinical depression can feel different to the sufferer. For one, clinical depression is stronger than a sad mood. States of clinical depression may be experienced as completely overwhelming. Clinical depression also lasts longer. Research that tries to map the typical duration of these states bears this out. Fortunately, ordinary sad mood will typically last hours or days. By contrast, the criteria for a major depressive disorder require a minimum 2-week duration, and typically, clinical depression lasts much longer, 4 to 6 months. The greater strength and duration of a clinical depression have real-world consequences for the sufferers. As Lonnie's mood deepened, and as she could not stop it, she became ever more fixated on why she was feeling so bad and why she couldn't shake it, a self-sustaining cycle that further deepens her mood. This underscores another potentially important difference, one that Lonnie notices, also typical of people who struggle with clinical depression. Clinical depression is more difficult to cope with than ordinary sad mood. When she experiences a normal sad mood, Lonnie can think of a dozen or more things she can do to cheer herself up, at least for a while. Watching her favorite show, eating a good meal, spending an evening with her girlfriends, spending half an hour at the gym, and even sometimes just taking a quick nap can all leave her feeling somewhat restored. By contrast, during her clinical depression, nothing she does seems to reliably lift her mood. For the past 3 months, Lonnie's mood has basically been a brick wall, explaining her deep frustration, her loss of hope, and why she has become obsessed with every tiny fluctuation in her mood. The distinct human experience of clinical depression is important to acknowledge. People who struggle with clinical depression often report that it feels different from an ordinary sad mood. This explains why people throughout history have perceived clinical depression in a strange and even frightening state. Lonnie, like many patients, says it's difficult for her to put her finger on exactly what's different, partly because it is so difficult to describe moods. She says that during her depression, rather than actually feeling sad, she feels numb and cut off from my feelings, like I have an urge to cry, but can't. Finally, clinical depression, in part because it is stronger and lasts longer than ordinary sadness, creates far more impairment than ordinary sadness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.